Parts of the Old Testament were written more than 7,000 years ago. We know this because, particularly in some of the earlier chapters, there are so many references to other gods of the day. None of them are mentioned by name. That, apparently, would give them more credit than they deserve. But they are referred to in phrases such as, "Thou shalt worship no other god before me," or "Thou shalt worship no graven images." One of the commandments even directs you not to pay any attention to these other gods. The graven images they were referring to, in at least the part of the Bible where Moses leads the Jews out of Egypt, are the stone and marble statues that were carved, probably by Jews supervised by Egyptians with whips, as actual images of the gods of the Egyptian pantheon. The Egyptian civilization is more than 6,000 years old. Egyptian gods included Osiris and Isis, a brother and sister who were king and queen of the underworld, and shockingly also consorts. The symbol for Osiris was the bull. The symbol for Isis was the throne. There was Seth, the brother of Osiris, who was a god of evil, trickery, and chaos. There was Hathor, the goddess of motherhood and love, who was the consort of Ra, who was sort of commander-in-chief of the gods. Ra, unlike all the others, was self-created. He was where it all came from, the sun. But then, with Hathor, he fathered Thoth, the god of the moon, wisdom and writing, and he fathered Horus, who was god of the earth. I suppose it was comforting to have all these gods around, living their lives, going through the same soap opera as everybody else, except on some super high-up level. That the Egyptians would have enslaved a people who said, no, there is only one god, and he's so far up there, even higher than Ra and the other gods, that we don't even get a chance to see what he looks like, well, that might be understandable. Anyway, the believers in this one god, Yahweh, is the pronunciation of what they called him from the Hebrew, held fast to their beliefs and broke their slavery chains and got away from the Egyptians in a series of very terrible and long, drawn-out negotiations that included the death of the Egyptians' firstborn. And they were allowed to leave, and so marched for 40 years through the desert until they came to the Holy Land, where they defeated a tribe known as the Philistines and set up a homeland for themselves there. They called it Israel, for they were the Israelites. The idea that a whole pantheon of gods was still popular can be seen by what happened in Greece. If the Egyptian civilization kept going for a few thousand years after the Jews left, a rival civilization developed across the Mediterranean Sea to the north at Greece. At this point, you had the Egyptians on the south shore of the Mediterranean, the Jews on the western shore, and the Greeks in the north. The Greeks considered the one almighty god system, but chose to go the multi-god route. It seemed to work for the Egyptians. In fact, the Greeks expanded on the system. There is no way the half dozen or so Egyptian gods even come close to the sheer numbers of Greek gods. Statues of Greek gods were just about everywhere in Greece, and it was actually hard to go anywhere without bumping into one or another of them. Many of them still stand to this day. There was Eros, god of desire, Aphrodite, goddess of love, Neptune, god of the sea, Ceres, goddess of grain, Hermes, god of translators and messengers of the gods, Apollo, god of healing, poetry and light, Ares, god of war, Artemis, goddess of the moon, Dionysus, god of wine, fertility, and ecstasy, Athena, goddess of wisdom, crafts, and war, a title she shared with Ares, and Hades, the god of the underworld, and there were dozens more. The Greek civilization declined, and in its place there rose up an even larger Roman civilization, also on the northern side of the Mediterranean, but further to the west. This time, though the Romans opted for the multi-god model, they decided they were simply too many gods in the old Greek civilization, and that maybe having so many helped bring the place down. The Romans therefore eliminated a number of god slots, or at least consolidated their power into some of the other gods. The Greek god Pan, for example, who had been in charge of forests, flocks, and shepherds, was eliminated. No new god was appointed to take over for Apollo, the god of healing, poetry, and light. We're talking a lot of pink slips here. As for the other gods, they continued along, but with Latin names rather than Greek ones. It is not clear to me, though it might be to someone who's made a deeper study of this, whether the new Roman gods had slightly different responsibilities and attributes than the Greek gods who had come before. Zeus, the Greek ruler of the gods, was now Jupiter, also the ruler of the gods. The god of war became Mars. The god of fire, Vulcan, not Hephaestus. Poseidon became Neptune. Artemis, the goddess of the moon, became Diana. You might have noticed that the names of some of these Roman gods are the same as the names of the planets in our solar system. Venus, who replaced Aphrodite, for example, is the name of a planet. Neptune, who replaced Poseidon as the god of the sea, is the name of a planet. The new messenger of the gods to replace Hermes is Mercury, another planet name. The fact is that the planets were discovered during the Roman era, and they were, for the most part, given away as gifts by Jupiter, the god of gods, to all of the lesser gods, though Jupiter kept the biggest planet for himself. At least, that is how the story goes. As you may know, the view of things at that particular time was that the Earth was the center of the universe and everything revolved around it. So it was no big deal to give a planet to a god, one here and one there. Through all of this, the Jews kept plugging away with their idea that there was only one god and that's all there was. It was not a particularly popular idea for a long time and it didn't take hold. So there were a lot more people around who believed in this whole pantheon of gods than there were people who believed in one god. And so when the Jews squared off against the Carthaginians, or the Persians, or the Romans, or even the Philistines, there were a whole lot more of the other people than there were of the Israelites. I can't tell you how many times the Jewish temple in Jerusalem got sacked. I think it was maybe 10 times. Finally, there was this whole dramatic business of Jesus, who said he was the Son of God and who others also said was the Son of God. From the Romans' point of view, it might have looked as if the Jews were finally coming around to the whole idea of a household of gods. They had two. One had fathered the other. Maybe there would be more. There weren't. There were instead the 12 apostles attesting to the miracles that Jesus performed. And there was the Last Supper and the betrayal and the death on the cross and the promise of a future in which the dead would rise from their graves. Today, 2,000 years later, the idea of Jesus and his Father, the one true God, has swept through Western civilization, converting one group of people after another to their way of thinking, even converting the Vikings, who around 700 AD developed a small pantheon of gods in what is today Norway, Finland, and Sweden. These gods were Jord, the god of the wind, the sea, wealth, and prosperity, also Tyr, god of justice and war, and Freya, goddess of fertility, birth, and the crops. You can see the gods were taking on several jobs here, all overseen by Thor, champion of the gods and god of lightning, thunder, and rain, and by Odin, god of war, death, poetry, wisdom, and magic. Sometimes I wonder how a particular Norse god might be expected to have talent in such diverse fields as war, poetry, and wisdom, but as I said, they didn't choose to have a lot of gods. And so today, Christianity is triumphant in much of the world. There are several billion adherents to Christianity and another 1 billion adherents to Islam, which believes in the same God as the Christians and Jews, but interpreted by an Arab prophet named Muhammad who lived around 700 AD. I wonder if there might be some place where all these old gods who didn't make it might be hanging out. Bacchus could be having a few drinks with Thor, Poseidon and Neptune could be comparing notes, Ra could be telling stories of the good old days in Egypt. These gods do live forever, you know.